around. So excited to be with you guys. I love the stories of Panama. My dad actually is from Panama. He was born in Colon, Panama, in the hood. And I got to actually visit Panama for the first time.
Carlos, they say that they invented break dancing in Colon, Panama, so that they could steal hubcaps off of moving cars.
100%. I believe it. I've been there. My dad took me back to the ghetto that he lived in, and you know, my dad is the perfect American dream story. My grandparents saved enough money for a one-way ticket from Panama City, Panama to LAX. Put my dad on a plane when he was 18 years old in 1956, with $20 cash and a shoeshine kit. My dad flew by himself, showed up at LAX, started shining shoes at LAX. Shined shoes for 2 years, made enough money for a semester of college, and then my dad ended up. He's now Dr. Fermin Whitaker. I mean, he, you know, he understands what it means to live that American dream, and why, honestly, like, we live in the greatest country, you know, in the world. And so, anyway, I say that I love the Panama connection here, but also, you know, have not ever been in the military, but I'm so grateful as a son of an immigrant for what you guys have done, Doc and Chuck and Tim and anyone that served. I'm just so grateful for what you guys have done for me and what I get to do now as a entrepreneur, or as a jobless entrepreneur now that isn't necessarily working. Just so grateful that you guys gave me an opportunity to come here. And you know, as I was listening to Doc and Tim and Chuck and all of us kind of where we're going, I had one thing that I was going to talk about, but God, Holy Spirit has just impressed on me somewhere to go somewhere else. So there's no notes for what I'm about to say. I had notes for something else, but I just feel impressed to really lean into what I feel like I'm seeing a common thread through this, and it's the fact that Holy Spirit is constantly speaking to us. I feel like as men, we have to get to an understanding that conversational intimacy with Holy Spirit and with Jesus is meant to be normal. It's not meant to be something that you're just supposed to go to church, wait for a sermon, hear a message, and that's what God's telling you, or you're just supposed to go to church, wait for the key change of the latest Hillsong or Elevation worship song, and it gives you goosebumps, and like that's the Holy Spirit speaking. Like, the truth of the matter is, Holy Spirit is speaking to us all day, every single day. And as men, the hamster wheel analogy that we've been talking about, that is going to be literally the one thing that the enemy is going to use to get you off track, is to speed you up. And I honestly believe that as men, what we need to do in order to hear the voice of God is to lower the volume of life, and then the volume of God is going to go up. You see, as men, what we end up doing is we lower the volume of God and we raise the volume of life. And so many men I talk to, they tell me, Carlos, like, you're always talking about hearing from God. You're always talking about God told me this, God told me that. I don't hear God. Like, what does God sound like? And the first thing I ask them to do is to take a look at their screen time on their phone, or how many hours a day they're doing, you know, they're consuming content. Like, we were not created to live at the speed that we are living. There's no way that when you look at our souls, you go back to the Garden of Eden, our souls were created for communing with God. And right now, the hamster wheel is 100%, it's what is destroying so many men's lives. And not men, but women as well. And so, you know, I think we take the scripture James 1:7, which says every good and perfect gift comes from God. And as men, so many times we translate it to every good and perfect gift comes from our hustle. But that's not what it says. The scripture actually says every good and perfect gift comes from above, not just some, but all of them. And I feel like as men, if we can get to that space, and here's the deal, God is committed to our maturing. If there's one thing that I know he's committed to, it is our maturing. And all of us know that we never mature when things are easy. We never mature on vacation. Vacation is not maturing time. But right now, during this time, when Chuck is under house arrest, basically, in Panama, he cannot leave. Like, God is committed to Chuck's maturing right here and right now. Every day now he's in the Word. And we have an opportunity to lower the volume of life right now. And the danger I'm scared of when things begin to open up is that we are going to suddenly lose the volume of God in our life because we're back out there hustling. We're back out there grinding. Now, is there anything wrong with hustle? Absolutely not. Is there anything wrong with being an listen, I'm an entrepreneur. I've got to like hustle in order to pay the bills. But I feel like God's saying, hey, Carlos, actually, that's how he says my name. Carlos, keep the volume of life low. Keep the volume of life down to where when the volume of life goes down, you're going to hear me so loud. You know, the enemy, we're living in warfare. If there's a theme throughout scripture, it's warfare. I mean, that's what it is. And again, in James, what's the scripture? James, hang on one second. James 4:7, that's what it is. So many Christians read that verse. It says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. But I'm telling you, I see far too many men take the word resist at the beginning of that and exchange it with the word ignore. The scripture does not say ignore the devil and he will flee from you. There has to be an action. There has to be something that we do to press into that. And let me tell you, the one thing that the devil, his only tactic is that he's a liar. I mean, that's it. Like he's just a liar. He's got nothing else on you. But the lie that he's telling so many men is that our identity is based on a nameplate, on a badge, on some success story of who we are. And can I tell you that your identity is not based on what other people feel like you are. Your identity is based on being a son of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So how can you today, listen, how can we continue to lower the volume of life so that the volume of God continues to go up? Once the volume of God goes up, this is the beautiful thing. This is the one thing that the enemy is so scared of. He's scared of the volume of God going up in our life because at that point, God is going to begin to tell you agreements that you've made with lies. Agreements in your life that you've made with lies. And when you finally hear those agreements with lies, that's why the enemy is screaming as loud as he can nonstop, because once we hear those agreements, guess what? Game over. Like at this point, you can break those agreements and you can finally find the freedom that God has intended for you. And speaking of agreements, you know, the agreement that I think we're all leaning into this morning is that our identity and our worth is based on, again, what other men believe, what the toys that we have, the stripes in our lawn, all these things. That, let's just be honest, like those should not be the things that define you. When you get to the space where God is beginning to speak to you and you are beginning to hear, I think you start to realize, when I look at the life of Jesus, the average pace that Jesus moved on a daily basis, let's be honest, is 3 miles an hour, okay? That's the average pace that a human being walks. Now, if I try to sell you something right now that moved at 3 miles an hour, you'd look at me like I was crazy, because like, what in the world could something that moves at 3 miles an hour give me? Well, can I tell you that if you copy and paste the life of Jesus onto your life, you're going to have to slow down. And in that slowing down, in that stillness is when you're going to begin to see the miracles, signs, and wonders in your life. Really quickly, I'd love for us to look at Exodus. And I think a beautiful example of what it means to lower the volume of life so that the volume of God goes up. There's a story in Exodus where it is, I got to find it real quick. It's the Israelites. I won't find the scripture, but the Israelites have been slaves in Egypt for thousands of years, right? And so they're breaking stones. I mean, this is like the worst slavery ever in the history of the Bible. Moses comes in, he frees them. Pharaoh's like, get out of here. You know, my people can go with you. So they're on the run. They're running as fast as they can. And then they end up at the edge of the Red Sea. Well, so they're at the edge of the Red Sea and they look in front of them and they're like, oh crap. Like there's an ocean in front of us. What are we going to do? Well, they look behind them and they see, it says the Egyptian army is right hot on their tail, and they begin to freak out. And this is what they tell Moses. They tell Moses, I love it. This is just like us, right? In this quarantine time, pandemic time, they're freaking out in the middle of the rescue. And they're like, oh God, Moses, why did you bring us out of Egypt to die in the desert? There were plenty of graves for us in Egypt. You should have left us in Egypt so that we could stay and serve the Egyptians. Now we're going to die in the desert. So if we look at the story for a second, we see that in the middle of God moving them to the promised land, they start to freak out when the world around them begins to crumble. And what do they want to go and be again? Well, they want to go and be slaves. So how many times do we whenever God's in the middle of our rescue, looks God square in the face and go, you know, God, I don't know if I can do this. I just want to go back to what, to my addictions and all the things that you've led me away from. But here's the beautiful thing. As they're freaking out, this is what Moses says to them. Moses says to them, stand still. I love this scripture. He literally says, stand still and you will see the Lord save you today. So what was the one thing that the Israelites had to do in order to get to the promised land? They had to stop. They had to lower the volume of life. And guess what happened? When they stood still, the volume of life went down. The volume of God, talk about miracle signs and wonders, went up because Moses took that staff, he stuck it in the ground, the sea split wide open, and they walked to the promised land. And again, my encouragement, which is a different encouragement that I had prepared, is just that we continue to keep the volume of life down so that the volume of God can explode. I promise you, men, Holy Spirit is speaking to you every moment of every day. That is what Holy Spirit was sent here to do. And once you get into a habit of hearing and obeying every day, all day, Lord, do you want me to go to this coffee shop or this coffee shop today? Lord, do you want us to go here or here? When you start getting that specific with God, you realize that we don't serve a vague God. We serve a very specific God, and your mind is going to be blown and your faith is going to go from mild to wild. So that's my encouragement to you men this morning, is just lean into the slowness and the volume going down in your life. And I promise you, you're going to experience miracle signs and wonders, and you're going to hear from God in ways you never have before. And that right there is when you finally get to enter war. Thanks, Chuck.
Wow.